Good morning, everybody, or afternoon. I'm still on jet lag. My name is Juan Andrés Guerrero-Saade. This is my partner in crime, Brian Bartholomew. We are very pleased that all of you didn't choose to go to that cloud talk across the hall. I promise this is going to be fun, at least funner than the cloud thing. So we're going to talk about false flags. I don't know if any of you are familiar with some of the material that we've already put out on this. Over the summer, Brian and I worked on an extensive paper on the subject. And the idea was that we got pretty sick of people talking about the threat of false flags and either blowing the possibility out of proportion as something that is always going to happen or keeping it as something theoretical that has never happened. Frankly, it's got to be somewhere in between, and we felt that the best way to handle this was to actually take the time to discuss some scenarios where that has already been the case to some extent or another. So for those of you that are unfamiliar with us, we are part of the Global Research and Analysis Team, or the GRAY team at Kaspersky Lab. This has actually put us in a great position, as you might be able to, you know, if you can see some of the details on the slide, this is some of the development of the different espionage operations and APTs that we have, our team has been involved in investigating over the past 5 or 6 years. And actually, that ends on 2015, so there's still a great deal of operations and new threat actors that have been added to it. So we're going to focus on attribution. We're going to focus, there's so many different stages of threat intel and different things that you tend to focus on in the cycle of producing threat intelligence, but we want to just focus on attribution, how attribution is done, why attribution is a problem, and hopefully we can all be on the same page to then go on to some examples of where deception tactics may actually come to play there.
So, the first thing we got to talk about is when we're talking about attribution, why is it such an issue? Couple things I put up here, but really the biggest ones I would kind of want to hit on is there's a lack of training mainly. I'm sure a lot of you guys and gals in the audience are government potentially, and for those of us that have come from that environment, a lot of us have had training on how to do proper attribution, you know, the subtleties of using certain languages and things like that. Unfortunately, in the public world, there's not a lot of training for this. So we're finding that there's analysts that are coming out, starting new in the business and not getting the proper training. Other than the other stuff up there, the other big one is the bad guys are reading all these reports. One thing we're finding is that as we put out reports talking about things that people are doing, different actors, techniques that they're using, they're taking those intel reports and they're using that information against us as researchers. And we'll show you a couple examples of that later on, but it's something to keep in the back of your mind that as we produce more and more of this publicly, it's gonna get harder to do attribution down the road.
So let me get a sense for the crowd. How many of you are actually analysts or work in threat intelligence? Show of hands. Okay, decent turnout. How many of you actually have read some of their reports on APTs, some of threat intelligence reports, maybe consumed some of it? Very cool. So these are some of the things that, for those of you that are not involved in this or might just have an interest in this, these are some of the interesting things that you can latch onto when you attempt to do attribution. Not yet. Let's hold off. I want to like take it slow so that everybody's on the same page. So some of those things might include compilation times, so you know when some of the malware was compiled, which allows us to make activity timelines. So since nation states and other more organized attackers are usually working on a 9-to-5 schedule, if you have enough samples, you can actually compile a timeline of when their schedule is. You know, they go to lunchtime and UTC plus 3 and, you know, have a sense of a general regional understanding where they may be. There's a lot that gets based on strings. So are there strings in a certain language? Are there debug paths, which are actually pretty cool when these people are really organized. If they leave a debug path, you not only get a username, but you might actually get their internal naming schemes for the operations and some of the malware. You've got other things like tasking and targeting, which are a particular favorite of mine because while you can manipulate a lot of things, you can't necessarily manipulate your interests. So the dynamic between attacker and victim is going to stay pretty much the same. So tasking is a really interesting one for intelligence analysts or the kind of people that are really into human to get an understanding of where some of these operations may be coming from. Command and control infrastructure or back-end connections, these are often misused, but yes, you can get a sense of where some of these servers might be. how they're going about registering them. Also, malware families and general code reuse is something that we use to cluster activity together. So you can say these 200 samples all fit together because the source code or some portions of the source code was reused in order to develop that malware. And sometimes you get, you know, encryption key reuse or password reuse. So these are all the kinds of indicators that threat intel producers latch onto when they want to say, you know, this is where this is coming from. The issue is every single one of the things I just mentioned can be manipulated in one form or another. Some of them can be faked seamlessly. That's not to say that they always are. And a lot of people make the mistake of thinking that the more advanced and the more well-resourced an attacker, it means that they're going to be perfect and they're never going to leave any trails behind. That's not true. But if we're going to say that this is a perfect science, everything that you can rely on is fungible. So it really isn't that kind of a practice where you can say, you know, all of our evidence is solid and we can make a perfect argument based on that. So in order to move forward and talk about deception tactics and manipulation of attribution indicators, we first need to ask for an allowance from the crowd. We at Kaspersky are attribution agnostic. We do not do attribution. And I hope for those of you that may have taken time to read the paper and those of you that are paying attention to this talk, I hope that it'll become abundantly clear why we don't do that. The thing is, while you can point to the evidence that might point you in a certain direction, it really isn't as solid as we'd like it to be, and sometimes people have put their foot in their mouth and had to walk back some claims, and we'd rather just never get into that space. We'd rather be researchers and say, these are some of the things you can latch onto, but we won't go so far as to actually make this attribution claim ourselves. Now, in order for us to say that we've been manipulated or that somebody's being deceptive, we do have to at some point claim where people think an operation is coming from and where the attacker would like us to think it's coming from. So we're asking you to give us the distance and the allowance of saying that some of the stuff came through the attribution grapevine. Some of it came from the rumors that people, you know, around the community or threat intelligence researchers might say. So give us that. Please don't say that these are some of our claims, and we'll give you some very cool examples of where threat actors are trying to get the better of us.
Okay. So that being said, we'll get right into it. The first group that we're going to talk about is a group called Cloud Atlas, also known as Inception. I think it was Blue Coat put a paper out on it originally a few years ago. But basically, these guys, what's really interesting about them is we think that they're a spinoff from Red October. If anybody's really familiar with Red October way back in the day, the theory was that this group was essentially like a joint venture between Russia and Ukraine. Once the annexation started occurring in Crimea, Cloud Atlas kind of popped up. And we think that maybe, through the attribution grapevine, that this could be potentially a Ukraine-based team, at a minimum Eastern European-based. What's really cool about them, though, is they rely on cloud services for a lot of their exfiltration, their data storage, and deployment of stage two. But they really make a concerted effort, or they were at least at the time, to deceive investigators. So I'll show you in a minute, but basically, every time they would see an investigator come in and touch their stuff or look and poke, they would do some things in there that would, you know, they were trying to throw people for a loop, which was really cool. And they are still active today. Their targeting was mainly based in Russia. They were hitting anything from government targets to media to pretty much anything based out and around Moscow. So we call them the Turducken of APT, which you'll see in a minute why. But basically, when they were first found, sorry that red doesn't really show up there, it says Spanish document name. The lure documents that were sent around from these guys actually contained a lot of metadata in it that was Spanish language, the internal contents of the document was Spanish. So initially, investigators thought, okay, maybe this is a Spanish APT. So started going down that path. Then we noticed in the mobile malware family that in the BlackBerry and the Android, there was Hindi and Arabic strings in those versions of malware, which was really interesting. So now we had Spanish metadata potentially, you know, created on a machine with Spanish language settings. We have Hindi and Arabic languages actually embedded inside the mobile malware code. Then we come across this quote, and there was God save the queen in the malware. And they capitalized the word the, which is really interesting, because actually most Americans would never do that, but obviously the Brits always proper, you know, capitalized the T on the Queen. So then we're like, okay, maybe this is coming from the UK. Then we looked at infrastructure, and the infrastructure they were using was a bunch of popped routers that were based out of South Korea. So you can see where, you know, all these little pieces and breadcrumbs, they're starting to pretty much lead people nowhere. It was pretty interesting. Then they deployed some Chinese malware, which was really cool. So like I was saying earlier, researchers started poking around. They started trying to solicit a stage two payload from the actors. And what was interesting is when the actors were watching the callbacks come in, if they suspected the victim of being a researcher, they would purposely push out a fake piece of Chinese malware versus their real stage two. So researchers were actually getting Chinese malware instead of the Cloud Atlas malware when they were looking at it. So they enjoyed messing with people, which was pretty neat. And then the last thing was going to compile times. Usually you can do kind of a trend analysis on compile times. You can say, okay, you know, all their malware was pretty much compiled between the hours of 9 and 5, you know, Moscow time or whatever. Doing a trend analysis on the malware we found here, you couldn't really do that. It was all over the place. So the conclusion was basically that every time they would compile a piece of malware, they would go into their system ahead of time and they would just change the clock settings. Compile the malware, the next piece, they change the clock, compile the malware. So again, left you scratching your head. So basically, you know, we were like, what the hell, right? So that's just the first one.
So, you know, that's the kind of thing that you get out of strings and you might get out of compilation timestamps. They've got some tricks there. The next case that I'd like to focus on is something that we called Wild Neutron. You might also know them as Morpho or Butterfly, depending on whose threat intel you like. I hope it's ours. And the interesting thing about Wild Neutron, it's actually one of my favorite cases, is they were extremely sneaky when it came to attribution. They basically wove all these different scenarios and tried to point people to not just with strings. I mean, I think the strings are the really simple part. You know, they had strings Romanian for goodbye. They had a transliteration of Russian for success, if I remember, yes, for success, remember correctly. But they also tried to point at like other researchers who might be like developing exploits who, well, they were white hat researchers, but they tried to point them in that direction. They tried to point at some scams. That's not the fun part of Wild Neutron. Wild Neutron is actually most interesting because of the tasking. Because if you're an old school analyst and you decide to say, hey, the only way we're gonna know where these guys are from is if we pay attention to who they're hitting. With Wild Neutron, you're gonna see that paradigm break down. They bagged some whales, they bagged some very big companies like Twitter and Apple. They went ahead and started hitting some smaller companies, some smaller tech companies. So they were, you know, they seem to be interesting in companies that are about to IPO. But then they were also interested in financial firms. So you say, okay, maybe there's a financial incentive. Then they started hitting law firms as well. It's like, okay, maybe it's still in the trend, but maybe not. But we're also, keep in mind that we're talking about a threat actor that uses 0 days and has quite a development cycle. So this is a relatively advanced team. They had no military or governmental or diplomatic hits, which is very strange for an APT, for a well-resourced attacker. However, for those of you that might be thinking that this is a financially motivated actor, they also went after counterterrorism targets. They started waterholing forums for Islamic extremism. That's not the kind of tasking that you would see with a purely financially motivated actor, nor are, you know, nor is M&A and IPOs and so on the kind of targeting you would expect for a proper APT actor. So what you actually get with them, I think, is the first case of a purely mercenary APT. And that's where your paradigm of being able to focus on tasking and targeting in order to do any kind of attribution starts to break down. What happens when a very well-resourced attacker will take money and a list of targets and use the same infrastructure and the same software to hit a bunch of diverse focuses or foci of interest? It really breaks down that paradigm. So, you know, that's one of the more interesting ways that this starts to break down for you. Now, if we can pull out to a different case, let's talk about APT actors that like to hide themselves as lesser grade actors. So for those of you that are interested in hacktivism, forgive me if I'm not paying as much attention to hacktivism. I tend to focus on APTs. I really like that kind of malware and don't pay that much attention to the hacktivists. However, some of the time, some of our guys like to pretend that they're hacktivists. They like to stand up fake fronts in order to carry out their operations and be able to say, hey, hey, this was done by this little hacktivist group, and it's the will of the collective internet that they've come to attack you. There's a weak version of that, and then there's a strong version of that. The weak version of that is what we call the Lazarus group. You may know them from the Sony hack and a series of other infamous hacks on South Korea. They really love to stand up these little hacktivist fronts for each one of their attacks. The issue is these hacktivist groups have no pedigree. They've never been seen before in any forums. They don't go on to exist after the attack. They literally just appear one day and they go, hey, we're the guardians of peace, and we have this very strong stance about this thing that you're doing. Pay us some money or we're gonna dump all your data. And then the next day they disappear. So it's only been good to mislead journalists for maybe a day, and then everybody goes back to the more likely actor. So that's the weak version of this. What's the strong version?
The big bad bear. So yeah, now we're gonna talk about the really fun stuff. Sophocy, I'm pretty sure everyone in this room knows about these guys. APT28, been in the news, especially in the past summer, year or so, but these guys have been around for a handful of years. They've been really good, but lately they've been super active. So traditionally, again, through the grapevine, based out of Russia, what's really cool about these guys is they have an immense amount of resources. They drop O-days like a Pez dispenser. I mean, I think we caught 4 in 1 month from these guys. They just have like unlimited exploits, basically. Their infrastructure is huge. They maintain, I think we pick up probably anywhere from a dozen to 20 new domains about every week that they're registering. It's crazy when you think about the amount of resources it takes to manage something that large. Their attack infrastructure is enormous. Targeting traditionally was government related. They were hitting foreign intelligence services, different ministries and things like that, all the traditional targets. Then we'll talk about it in a little bit, but they've moved on. They were doing some counterterrorism work, actually, that was focused on CT-related stuff for Russia. And then they actually started targeting media as well as what you would consider dissidents within Russia. Again, large amount of resources. And lately, they love to mess with people. They've been doing some pretty interesting things with false fronts. So initially, back before, say, 2015, their TTPs were very common for an espionage actor. They were stealthy. They didn't want to get caught. They were careful with what they did. Their OPSEC was actually pretty good. Not the best, but they were pretty good. Then right around 2015, which was right around the time, I believe, that Crimea started, they got kind of careless, and their OPSEC kind of went out the window. They were pretty brazen about things. They didn't really care if they got caught. They would just basically walk in, smash the window, take what they want, walk out. Thanks. So kind of interesting, big shift in their TTPs. Again, their targeting actually shifted right around the same time as well. They went from targeting ministries and traditional government-type targets. They started hitting media, policy influencers, think tanks, and then they started targeting elections. And they've actually hit 2, not just ours. They've actually hit 2 elections so far. And right around that time is when their deception operations started as well, and we'll go through a couple of those fronts that we suspect are theirs or that have been confirmed as being theirs. And again, it kind of coincided with the Ukrainian conflict, the annexation in Crimea. Why the shift in TTPs? I don't know. I mean, you could kind of say, well, there was an increased operational tempo maybe. They had so much stuff that they had to accomplish. There was so much stuff going on. Not really sure, but there was definitely a huge shift right around that time. So we've changed our slides a little bit on this one. What I wanted to do was, I want to put on one page everything that we know that they've hit in the last couple years. And it's pretty eye-opening. I'm pretty sure most of you would know these onesie twosie you've read in the news here and there. But to see all of these targets on one page, it's pretty crazy to think about what they've done in the last 2 years.
If I can interject for a little bit before we kind of do the really revealing slide. I don't know how many of you may have seen our paper before this. We actually dropped a sizable paper on most of this research, but we wrote it at the beginning of the summer, before all the election hacks, before all these really notable drops that were related to fancy varisophacy and so on. And when we put together the paper, the idea that they were putting these false fronts forward was kind of outlandish. It wasn't really acceptable. We wrote the paper, we started kind of putting this information out there, and then so much happened that now it's perfectly acceptable or believed that it is sophacy behind these different fronts. So we wanted to kind of shift things a little bit so you can get a snapshot view of just how active they have been over the past year or so, and kind of get an understanding not just of the fronts that you already know about, but how much of a trend it has been for this actor over the past 2 years.
Yeah. So, okay, so they started off, Ukrainian government, obviously. Not only the government, but they actually went in, they blocked cell phone calls for government officials. They hacked billboards. They hit critical infrastructure. They targeted the election committee in Ukraine. Crazy stuff for an actor to go in and just do this. And they really didn't care. I mean, we'll tell you in a minute, you know, the front that they were using, but they were like, yeah, whatever. Then they moved on, and they've hit German Bundestag and Parliament. They've actually hit them at least twice now. And if anybody's familiar with what elections are coming up in 2017, you've got France, you've got Germany, and I believe we're actually starting to see targeting in Greece right now as well. So I don't know, maybe we'll be doing this talk in a, you know, next year, and we'll talk about the German election cycle. They went ahead and they hit the Warsaw Stock Exchange. This one was really cool, actually. Not for Poland, obviously, but the leader of Poland came out when the Crimean conflict was happening, and they said, okay, we're moving all of our troops to the border of Russia because we're terrified at what's gonna happen. So we're just, you know, kind of flexing our muscle, pushing all of our troops up there. 2 days later, the Warsaw Stock Exchange gets hit, and it's plastered all over the internet, and it was basically a giant middle finger. And they said, hey, okay, fine, we'll hit your stock exchange. Then they turned their attention to media outlets. They hit the US media, they hit Newsweek. They hit some media outlets in Maryland, Arizona, I believe. Yeah, there was one in Baltimore. They were sending fake ISIS propaganda across on news, like text alerts. So anybody that had subscribed to that local media station to get text alerts for certain news, they were getting SMS messages from ISIS, essentially, on their cell phones. Why they were doing it, I don't know, causing havoc. They targeted the French media. The TV5 Monde incident, they were able to shut down, I think it was like 12 stations nationally throughout France, and they actually broadcast ISIS propaganda across that as well. They hit CENTCOM. They hacked CENTCOM's Twitter account, and they plastered an ISIS banner right across on CENTCOM's Twitter page. Kind of funny to see that, but they didn't like it too much. We have the Saudi Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Now this one I put suspected there. I'm a firm believer that this was them. Other people don't believe that it was. If you'd like to know more about that, we kind of go into it in the paper a little bit, but it was with a group that they created called Yemen Cyber Army. And we do know that they've actually hit the Saudi MOFA. But the leaks, the cable leaks that happened around, I think it was May or June of 2015, we're not really sure 100% if that was them or if it maybe was another actor. Then more recently, they hit WADA and TASCAS, which is the Court of Arbitration for Sport. Olympics happened. Russia got kind of smacked pretty hard with the anti-doping stuff. They turned around and they just smacked WADA back. And they hit WADA, they stole a bunch of information, they published a bunch of stuff about Americans and other athletes that were also in the system for doping. They hit the Court of Arbitration as well. Pretty interesting stuff. Then, of course, over the summer, we had the DNC, DCCC, the Podesta leaks. They went after the Bradley Foundation. They tried to actually show, they manipulated data to make it look like the Bradley Foundation had donated all these millions of dollars to the Clinton campaign. Just crazy to see all of that on one page. As far as the personas that they've used, so, you know, typically when you're an espionage actor, you don't want to be publicly out there doing this stuff, right? It's kind of plausible deniability. You want to have that fake front. So they started creating these personas. The first one, when it was with relation to Ukraine and a couple other things, was Cyber Berkut. Back when I think it was Yanukovych was kind of ousted out of Ukraine, the Berkut, which was his like kind of secret police force, was disbanded. And then all of a sudden, Cyber Berkut pops up. They're kind of the cyber arm for the police force, supposedly. This was the front that Sophocy was using at the time to do all these attacks against Ukraine. Then on came Cyber Caliphate. They were the supposed cyber arm of ISIS. They used this to hit CENTCOM. You can see in the bottom left, that was actually off of CENTCOM's Twitter page, I believe, was that image there. Then we have Yemen Cyber Army. Again, kind of popped out of nowhere. YCA was the ones that hit Saudi Ministry of Foreign Affairs and then turned around and dumped all those classified cables and things out on the internet. Then we had the Guccifer, whatever you want to call it, 2.0, which was kind of funny. I thought that was interesting. But yeah, this summer. We had DC Leaks, which was created. The best one of all of them was Fancy Bear's hack team, right? So, good friend of mine over at CrowdStrike, you know, they call it Fancy Bear. And the actor actually, I thought it was pretty funny, adopted that name, and they registered a domain, fancybears.net, I think it was. And they created the Fancy Bears hack team. And then they turned around and used that persona to do all that stuff that I just showed you on the other screen. So, you know, I mean, they just don't care anymore. It's really interesting. But again, all they need is that plausible deniability, right? If they can just get people to kind of second guess, is this really Sophocy that's doing this, or is this somebody else? That's all they really need, right? Oh, and then there was AM Poland. Juan can probably talk about that one, but down at the bottom right corner, that's actually his Twitter handle. And he was targeted by...
I'm on some Sophocy list, apparently. So if you can see down there, the funny story about this one is we follow Sophocy to the T, and we tend to follow a lot of their domain registrations, and we, you know, work on their stuff even before it becomes public. And we were in the process of writing a private report. We have a subscription service, and people get early reports in the research that we do. And we were writing a private report on how we could see that they were hitting WADA and TaskCast because we had seen the domain registrations. And halfway through this work, I get a Twitter notification, and it's actually this fake front from Sophocy directly tweeting at me and a bunch of other researchers and news outlets, basically saying, "Come check out this leaked information from WADA and TaskCast."
Yeah.
So clearly they've compiled a list of researchers as well. And
as far as just real, I mean, I think we have like 20 minutes left or something.
Quick.
But like as of a few weeks ago, they were actually stealing documents from WADA still and then turning them around. And then they were going to journalists in Russia and they're saying, "Hey guys, we've got all this leaked data from WADA, would you like it?" And the journalists are freaking out and saying, "Yeah, cool." Well, they're actually Trojanizing the documents that they stole from WADA so they can target the journalists. So, yeah, it's crazy.
We laugh. Someone's not that happy.
Yeah, there's
all right,
people
that aren't. So, moving on to a different paradigm, you know, as much as we enjoy the fanciest of bears, what happens when you're talking about APT on APT action? You know, the more popular this research gets and the more of you that can name different threat actors, the easier it becomes for an APT actor to just say, "Hey, as long as they don't think it's me, but they think it's somebody else, somebody in China or whatever, that's fine by me as well." So this is one of my favorites, you know, the illest of them all, Dooku 2. For those of you familiar with them, I mean, they're quite famous from their first go around, but Dooku 2 was actually quite a marvelous improvement. And they thought that we would like it so much that they hand delivered it to our offices, which we really appreciated. We took a lot of time to analyze this one. And the cool thing about Dooku 2, and again, this is kind of like a snide, tongue-in-cheek way of doing it, but all of it is memory resident except for these drivers that sit on domain controllers. So one of the versions actually had the term Romanian anti-hacker, which I believe is an homage to somebody very dear to dear to us. But in the other version actually had Wang Dong, had Ugly Gorilla as one of the strings in there. And for those of you that might remember the APT1 report and, you know, the five PLA members that were indicted on the basis of this report, Ugly Gorilla is the handle for Wang Dong, one of these people. If you think that Dooku 2 is in any way related to APT1, I mean, we could sell you just about anything, but it was a really weak attempt at basically taking any researchers whose skills might just consist of Googling strings and hopefully sending them on a wild goose chase. Now, the cooler version of that, and this is actually some research that hasn't been published, it's something that we did privately and we gave to our subscribers. This is one that I'm particularly fond of, it's called Tiger Milk. And I'll be perfectly frank with you. It was a 6-month operation targeting one country in South America, and the malware sucked. It sucked. It was bad, it was clunky, it messed with the desktop. You would have been able to tell that you were infected just because your machine wasn't working right. But what makes it really interesting is every one of the samples was signed with this certificate. Now, are there any nerds in the room that might be able to recognize what the certificate is, this Realtek certificate? Anybody seen this before? I see. No, Microsoft. It's, there you go. Yes, and you can ask him about this here in the second row. This was the exact same certificate that they used to sign Stuxnet A and B, presumably a stolen certificate from Realtek. Now, what makes this really interesting is the certificate was stolen for the purposes of Stuxnet, but it was not publicly released. Moving on from that, it was also invalid. So it didn't provide any tactical or technical prowess or ability to have your malware signed with the certificate. So as far as we can tell, the only purpose for doing that, beyond the complication of getting your hands on the certificate, was in order to mislead incident responders into thinking that this was somehow related to the Stuxnet team. Interesting. Still don't know how they got that cert.
All right. Last one we'll talk about here is Turla. Hopefully most of the folks in here know about Turla, but they're a group that's very near and dear to me as well. Again, popular belief is that they're Russian. We'll try to churn through this pretty quick. But these guys are really smart. They do some really cool stuff with SIGINT. They do some satellite-based exfil, which is pretty phenomenal. I would encourage you to go read the report on that. And they've been around probably since 1997. In terms of espionage operations, that makes them like the great-grandfather of cyber espionage. I mean, they were one of the very first teams out there. What's cool about them is we had a case that's kind of referred to as Faking Dragon, but basically they were on a very important target. And when they were on this target, they started noticing, once investigators were poking around on the box, they saw that the incident response teams were starting to run tools and things on the box. So they did something that was really interesting. The very first stage was actually WIPBOT, which is one of their normal stage ones that they would use. But then what they did was, as soon as they saw the researchers on the box, they turned around and they pushed out a stage two, which at the time was this fake TLS Quarian variant, which was a kind of a rare thing at the time. Nobody really knew what it was. But actually what was interesting about it was already compiled malware. And it talked back to an infrastructure that was in Beijing. And it was just a piece, they ripped off a piece of Chinese malware. It wasn't even theirs. That infrastructure wasn't even Turla's. They had nothing to do with it. But they put that malware on the box to send the researchers down this crazy rabbit hole. And the researchers are like, was this the Chinese on the box? Like, what's going on? Meanwhile, Turla, doing the little head fake thing, they went in and they took all their stuff off. They backed out completely, cleared all the logs because they left the box on the internet, and they were gone. Pretty interesting. And they're still doing this technique. I just picked up on it again like 2 weeks ago. Yeah. So pretty interesting. Other theories, obviously, Turla is Chinese, they're working with China, whatever, but I don't really think so. So
that's kind of a whirlwind of examples, because, you know, like we said, we were kind of very sick of the idea that this is some sort of theory and that for the meantime, we can't actually discuss this in concrete terms. We obviously can discuss it in concrete terms. And I think that it's useful, not just for the sake of saying, you know, here's a gallery of examples, but rather to say, what are the takeaways that we can get from some of this, and what is some of the understanding level of attribution that you actually require from your threat intel?
So, yeah, the first thing is, I'm sorry, what was the time on that? 10? Okay. So the first thing we want to talk about is what level of attribution do you need? As a consumer or someone who, you know, kind of reads these reports, like, what do you actually need? So that we kind of split it up into three. There's government, there's private sector, and yes, actually, the media is one of these consumers as well. We'll talk about that in a minute. So under government, obviously, you need the most fidelity with your attribution. You've got to know, who the individual was, what the unit was that actually conducted the attacks. Why? Because if you're going to leverage sanctions or demarches, or if you're going to go back after them with cyber operations, you better know who you're going after, because it's, you know, pretty serious stuff. Moving on to the private sector, this is where it gets really weird. People in the private sector feel like they need that small, you know, granular attribution, but in reality, they really don't. Individual attribution is sexy, not needed. What you really need is you need to know maybe what country it came from, or what their target was, or what their motivation was, right? You need to know where to redirect your resources to better defend against that stuff. But you really don't need pictures of an actor, you know, riding his bike throughout downtown Beijing. And then the media. So this is interesting. The problem we have with the media is that when you talk to them, a lot of times they ask the question, who did it? It's the first thing they want to know. They want the sexy, you know, it was this guy, whatever. Unfortunately, they don't ask why. A lot of times, you know, they kind of pressure researchers into kind of saying what the attribution is, but they don't really say, well, show me why you came up with this, attribution. So it's a problem. We really need to fix it.
So in order to walk away with hopefully some conclusions, and I'm hoping to actually leave a few minutes for questions, since I know that we're kind of pushing up to it. Give us a little bit just to give you some conclusions, we'll go for questions. So real quick, it's really important to distinguish between threat intelligence, IT, and IR. There's a lot of people who confuse the functions of these, and especially when you're a company that has IR, it's very easy to think that you've got threat intelligence covered. The truth is, threat intelligence does something very different than incident response. It actually provides you with a historical context. And that's irreplaceable when you're looking into these sorts of operations. It's what keeps you from being beguiled by somebody throwing Chinese malware in the middle of an incident, pulling out all their stuff, and then you actually don't know how to interpret some of the previous connections or what was actually happening. There's also, we have to be frank, there are uniquely positioned entities to do attribution, and we are not one of them. And chances are that if you're in this room as a threat intelligence provider, neither are you. The truth is that if the true measure of fidelity for an attack is a PCAP or being able to watch the net flow of the attack, you should be talking to the signals intelligence agencies. And it's not to say that they can't do attribution, but they're kind of in a modern Cassandra dilemma where when they tell us what they know, we don't believe them because they can't substantiate it. So it's sort of a sad state of affairs as far as that goes.
It sucks. I don't envy those folks at all. So takeaways. There's like four things we just want to make sure as you leave here, you know, think about this in the back of your mind when you're going back and kind of thinking about what we just talked about. So the first part is, if you can't really do attribution, we've just demonstrated just a handful of cases where, you know, actors are purposely trying to, you know, manipulate things and fake researchers out to make attribution harder. If you can't really do that reliably, what happens with some of these vendors that you probably will see downstairs, where they talk about active defense or, you know, hacking back, whatever you want to call it, you really can't do it. I know I don't want to put my neck on the line and do that back at someone and then be wrong about the attribution. It makes things really interesting. I would stay away from it. Again, to what extent do you need that attribution? Think about it in terms of, you know, what sector you're in. If you're a financial company, or let's just say you do business in China, but you don't do business in the Middle East, for example. Maybe you should be focusing your efforts on APTs that originate out of, you know, Asia, for example. Don't worry about the South American APTs as much. Clustering of activity, again, kind of goes to what I was just talking about, but, you know, do you really need to know about this was GRU, or do you need to know this was Russia? Or do you just need to know this was APT-28, right? SOFACY, it's a cluster of activity. That's how you defend. You know the TTPs. Does it really matter if his name is Ralph or George or whatever? I don't know. And the biggest thing is, Ralph, not really a Russian name, but yeah. So the last part, if you're a producer of threat intelligence, please, when you write these reports, I know it's nice to throw attribution in there and make things really sexy, but what actionable intelligence are you actually providing in the report? Are you putting out a 60-page paper that really people that are consuming it, they can't do anything with it? There's no real intelligence in there to you know, IOCs and things like that they can take back and use for defense. you know, if you're not doing that, shame on you. As a producer, we need to do a better job at that and make sure that we're putting as much actionable intelligence as we can into the reports.
And so, with that, we've left a really brief amount of time for questions. So if anybody wants to line up at the microphones, we've got about 5 minutes. Thank you all for coming. And
could you expound on your logic there at the end, where you, in particular for the private sector and the media, it talked about the various ways they should deal with attribution. Can you give your logic?
Yeah, so I kind of rushed through that because I was afraid of time. But basically, you know, let's say you're a private sector business. You have a finite amount of resources, right? You don't have the resources of the U.S. government at, you know, at will that you can just dedicate to monitor everything. So what you really need to do is use attribution maybe at the country level to kind of maybe cross-reference that with maybe where you do business and where your resources are to better kind of point your people in the right direction to focus on just that area versus you're not going to be able to cover everything.
If I can I put an asterisk on that? We're talking about how you deploy your resources as far as incident response and administration. That's not to say where you go for the information you want to be ingesting. We're firm believers in providing global threat intelligence. I mean, you really need to have kind of situational, a general situational awareness before you can even say what applies to you and not. Because yeah, maybe you don't have business in China, but you're working at a certain vertical that's interesting to a certain type of threat actor. The idea is when you have that information and you know what applies to you, yes, of course, you're gonna wanna prioritize the teams that are gonna affect the region that you operate in, the vertical that you operate in, or that have any, you know, kind of particular interest in your domain over just trying to ingest, you know, mountains of feeds and waves of all this kind of data that isn't really valuable to you.
And regarding the media part, I just want to make sure, like, if any journalists are actually in the audience, you know, your job is to dig on this stuff. And what we find a lot of times is, again, they ask the question who, but you get a lot of very, I guess, immature threat intel organizations that are trying to make a name for themselves, and they can be pressured very easily into making attribution claims that really aren't substantiated. And as a journalist, I think it's your duty to really, if you're going to push for that answer, to then follow it up and say, why exactly are you saying this? Give me the data that actually says this is that group. If you don't do that, then you're just adding fuel to the fire, basically.
Any other questions?
Sweet.
We're done?
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.